Okay, we're gonna get started. Welcome everyone to our event tonight. Just for a quick introduction, my name is Ariana Duckett. I am a graduating senior psychology major on the pre-medical track from Waldorf, Maryland. Very excited to be hosting our admissions representative, Ms. Ramos from Columbia Vagelos College of Physicians and Surgeons. And this event is in collaboration with FIDE and Morehouse College. So Alonzo or anyone from FIDE, if you would like to quickly introduce yourself and your organization, feel free to.
Hello, all. My name is Alonzo Fedrick. I am a graduating senior, biology and chemistry double major, public health minor on a pre-MD PhD track from Miami, Florida, by way of Fort Lauderdale, Florida. And I attend Morehouse College, and I'm the presiding president of Morehouse's medical fraternity, Phi Delta Epsilon. Thank you so much for having us, Ariana. We really appreciate the invite. And we're looking, forward to the event today.
Thank you so much, Alonzo, for the introduction. I'm now going to turn it over to Ms. Ramos so that she can introduce herself and get started with the presentation tonight.
Thank you, Ariana. This is amazing. I'm just so happy to be here tonight. Just want to let everyone know, do not feel compelled to turn your camera on. It is totally fine to keep it off for tonight. I will have a student join in just a little bit later. I think she's wrapping up class right now to give you a little more of the student perspective. But my name is Kiana. I've been working with Columbia for about 4 years, started in student affairs, and now I'm currently working in admissions for the past two. I am a native New Yorker, born and raised in the South Bronx. Went to The Ohio State University. And fun fact is, I am a member of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, Incorporated. But yeah, I'm just so happy to be here. I'm gonna start by sharing my screen. And let me just make sure that you can hear. Let me hide this so that way you don't see any big black boxes. And then if someone can just come off the mic and let me know that you can see. Or you can hear. You're good to go? Okay. Awesome. So, the Vagelos College of Physicians and Surgeons, or we like to refer to as VPNS, because we know that can be quite long of a name, is located in Upper Manhattan in the Washington Heights section. So, if you've ever been to New York City or you're familiar with New York City, you might be known Central Park. That's where the park sign is. So, we're located just north of that. Our main campus is located on Morningside, which is another part of Harlem. Harlem West and Harlem East. Morningside is more on the west side of Harlem. If you're familiar with Times Square, which is, where our big red steps, all the jumbotron TV screens are, our jumbotrons, that is located in Midtown West, right just below Central Park. And then if you are familiar with the Statue of Liberty, that's in Battery Park, so that's pretty south. But we're pretty north. I like it a little bit better up here. It gives you a little more quiet city vibes, if that's something that you're into. So Washington Heights has a very, very large Dominican population, but it does not take away from the cultural melting pot that is this community around us. If you did see the movie In the Heights, or if you ever seen the Broadway play In the Heights, it is inspired by the Washington Heights community. The movie is more recent and actually shows literally parts of campus, which is why it's one of my favorites. But yeah, Washington Heights has so many things to do, whether it's hanging out at some of the local restaurants. Here at the bottom right, you'll see what's now called the Hudson. It used to be called La Marina. And it was a popular spot for a lot of like celebrities. A lot of people like to go there because you can oversee the Hudson River as well as the George Washington Bridge. So it's a nice romantic spot to go to, but they also love to dance. So it's also a nice fun spot. And then the United Palace is literally just a few steps from our campus building. It's one of New York's biggest landmarks. It's really known. Beyonce did her Target ad in their auditorium. John Wick 3 was also filmed there. And hopefully this year when we do our revisit or what we call second look for admitted students, we're hoping to have it there as well. But yeah, Washington Heights is just so full of culture, from food to people. It's one of my favorite places. So much so that I actually recently just moved up here from the Bronx, if that gives you any idea of how much of a great community it is. And I'm gonna apologize if you ever hear any honking. New York City is quite live and active, so I just apologize in advance now. But here you'll see the Little Red Lighthouse. It's another landmark of New York City. A lot of our students like to go here and take selfies. If you are a student who likes a little more greenery, want a little more relaxation, maybe you just had a stressful exam or something, you want to go decompress, This is a popular spot for our students. It's located right underneath the George Washington Bridge and literally just what, three blocks away from our campus. So a lot of students will go here. Springtime, summertime is probably the best time to go. Would not recommend in the winter. However, it is a place that you still can go to in the wintertime too. Sure, the snow pictures would probably look just as good as the sunny ones. Here is some of our students located on the High Bridge. It's the oldest bridge in New York City, connects Northern Manhattan to the High Bridge section of the Bronx. They recently renovated it, so it's a full-on pedestrian bridge now, which means you don't have to worry about cars, maybe bikes, but not cars. And you can also sit along the bridge. So it's really nice because it overlooks the Hudson River as well. You can also see the New York City skyline when you sit up there, and the sunset is really pretty up there as well. So sometimes our students and our professors will go and take a nice little walk across the High Bridge. So this beautiful building to the right is the Vagelos Education Center. It's literally home to all of us, to the administration, to our students. It's where we have our state-of-the-art simulation center, our anatomy labs. It's where our students have their classes each and every day. It's about 14 stories high and has some of the best views of New York City, you ask me. We do have a glass cascade that you can go literally from the 14th floor all the way down to the first floor, and even the cellar. And it's just a beautiful place to call home. It's very relaxing. A lot of students do study there as well. So let's get to the nitty gritty. At the time of application, there are four tracks that you can apply into. Our first is our regular ND track, and that's mainly what I'll focus on for my presentation today, just because some of the other tracks have a little bit different admissions requirements, as well as they have a little more details that go into their programs that are more case by case. So the regular MD track is your typical four-year track of study. And as I mentioned, I'll go over more details of what that's gonna look like. Our Columbia Bassett track is similar to the regular MD track, except during your major clinical year where you'll be in the hospital completing clerkships, you do that up in Cooperstown, New York. It's more of a rural setting. So if you're more into a longitudinal patient care that's more rural and serve that underserved population, then the Bassett track may be for you. The three-year PhD to MD track is for those who've already obtained a PhD and are looking to complete that MD component. Maybe you're interested in biomedical informatics or a career along that line, then the three-year PhD to MD might be for you. And then the MD PhD is our longest track. Usually it takes about 7 to 8 years to complete. Very rarely is it completed in six, very rarely, more so to the eight. And this is for anyone who wants to take that research and that clinical component, combine it together. Maybe you're looking to go into biomedical investigation or something along that career line, then the MD PhD track might be along for you. So this is what our four-year curriculum currently looks like. So for the first 16 months or a year and a half, you'll do what we call fundamentals. You complete these foundations to clinical medicine courses, or clinical gross anatomy, psych, body and human health and disease. You'll have the data science course, which is new. And then you also complete what we call a ready for MCY, so ready for major clinical year course. And then fundamentals is the only time that summer is the only time that you'll have a summer break. After that, it's straight studies and clerkships, but I'll go into a little more details of what some of our students like to do during that summer break. But once you complete those fundamentals, those 16 months, you go into what we call major clinical year or what we call MCY. And so during MCY, this is where you'll complete the core clerkships that are required for graduation. And I'll let you know what those are in just the next slide. But during that time, that year, you have 2 weeks in which you return back to the classroom, learn a little more, get to see your classmates again before you go back out into that major clinical year. You have about 2 to 3 months of board prep before you go into the last curriculum, which is differentiation and integration, or what we call D&I. This is where you must complete a scholarly project and you also will complete electives. Some students tend to do away electives. Some do stay within the New York City tri-state area. If you do decide that you want to pursue the three-year PhD to MD track, the scholarly project is waived for you because you've already had that research component. So during a major clinical year, the class size is roughly around 140. And so we break into eight groups of about 18 to 20 students, and they're going to rotate through the following clerkships together. So you have medicine, you have neurology, neurosurgery, ophthalmology, obstetrics and gynecology, pediatrics and otolaryngology. A mouthful always, primary care, psychiatry, surgery, anesthesiology, and then a subspecialty. And these are the times that usually take to complete those clerkships. So you'll have like 6 weeks, or a total of 10 weeks of medicine, 5 weeks of OB-GYN, about 6 weeks of peds and otolaryngology. Primary care is about 5 weeks. So these are also the timelines in which, and things are always changing. We're always trying to upgrade and be better and do better. So this is our current cycle, current schedule, but it can always change. Just like to give that as a precursor. So research and scholarly projects, there are numerous opportunities that our students will get engaged in a research or global health project, but some of the ideal times are that first, that summer between your first and second year. So instead of taking a summer break, a lot of our students will decide to go ahead and do a global health project. We have an amazing global and population health office that's really dedicated to finding opportunities that fit your interest and your niche. And then during the electives and scholarly project months during the D&I phase is another popular time. Some popular scholarly project or research areas that students will go into are med ed, basic science, clinical research, again, collaborating with the Global and Population Health Office, and then narrative and social medicine. Narrative and social medicine has really picked up since it's been incepted. Fun fact, our Dean of Admissions is actually enrolled in narrative medicine and pursuing another degree in that as well. We do have the opportunity to pursue a dual degree if that is something that you're interested in. So of course you could do the MD PhD track. If you would like, you can do an MD MS in biomedical engineering, an MD MS, an MD MPH, an MD MBA, or 1 year MS in either narrative medicine, bioinformatics, or bioethics. And so what the dual degree kind of looks like is you'll complete the fundamentals, you'll complete your MCY, and during pretty much the third year of medical school is where you would take a time off. You'll work with our Dean of Student Affairs to get an extended curriculum form filled out. It's really simple. She just gives you the approval and then you go ahead and you complete that extra degree. And then you come back and you complete the last phase of med school. So it's really important that our students are exposed to the world around them and that they're best like well-rounded when it comes time to, especially applying for residency and just getting that experience. So we do have a plethora of global health opportunities, but these are just a few. And as I mentioned, we have an amazing global and population health office. So again, these are just some of our most popular, but definitely there are thousands and thousands and thousands of opportunities for students to get involved globally. So some popular ones are Millennium Villages Project, which helps to eradicate poverty on the village level in sub-Saharan Africa. Our Ben-Gurion University of Negev does a foreign exchange student program with us. So we'll send a student to Israel, they'll send a student over here. Again, just exploring those global health electives or those scholarly projects during the D&I phase. Our International Center for AIDS Care and Treatment Program, or what we call ICAP, is a partnership with our Mailman School of Public Health. And they really look at new ways in trying to help treatment programs for AIDS and HIV. And then the Program for Global and Population Health at VPNS, or Dígame, Dígame, Bienvenidos, Dígame Más. Dígame is a great program in getting you to learn the cultural history and significance of Washington Heights, because you will be here for 4 years if you decide to attend. And so we really wanna make sure that you're just culturally immersed in the population around us. We do know that we service a big, large Dominican population, Spanish population, and that's the history of Washington Heights. So Dígame does an amazing job at getting you just enough information and getting you well-rounded in the community around you that you are while you're here. So we do have, 17, I always laugh when I get to this page because the young man on the right who's holding the free shirt sign, his name is PK, and he's actually our former admissions rep. He's passing the torch over to someone else, but he's just a ball of fun, so he always makes me laugh. But yeah, PNS Club, we have about 70 co-curricular and extracurricular organizations here for students that represent their vast interest. And so PK is part of the Free Weight Club. So they were handing out t-shirts at the PNS Club Fair. We have our coffee house, which is an opportunity for our students to showcase their many talents, whether it's poetry, whether it's rap, spoken word, whether it's DJ. Actually, one of the M2s DJed this past weekend, which I thought was awesome. And just a bunch. A lot of people play like the guitar, the saxophone, any instrument. So it's just a fun vibe for students to kind of come out and party and celebrate with each other. We have our Broadway Haven Players, or BHP, and they do 3 full-on length productions each academic year. Our rugby team competes intercollegiately. We have a symphony orchestra and a musician's guild. Some of our students compete in triathlons. And then the student life at VPNS. So people always ask, like, what's the one thing that stands out about VPNS? And I always say it's the community. The people here, from the staff to the faculty to the students, are just amazing. And so we try to make sure that the students have the best experience possible. And so one of my favorite things about being in student affairs is the events. And so a lot of signature events that we'll do is, like, we do a boat cruise every year for the students. Here the students at the Yankees game. They have an advisory dean. I'll go into a little bit more what that support program is. But they have an advisory dean, which they call themselves houses now. So this was a house at dinner, and they just enjoyed themselves at dinner. And then there's big, large class photos, actually our most recent incoming class, the class of 2026. And we were actually at the little picture I showed you before at La Marina, or now the Hudson. And we gave them just a dinner and a DJ and had a little fun night for them, just welcomed them in during orientation. Some of our affinity groups. So we have the Black and Latino Student Organization. We have a PAMSA, which is our Asian and Pacific American Medical Student Association. LAMDA, which represents our LGBTQ plus students. And then we have FLIP, which is for our first generation low income partnership students. And so this is just a little bit of them all on this screen. On the bottom left is the students at the boat cruise. They took that picture, I believe, last year. So as well as global health opportunities, service learning opportunities are important. And so we do have student run clinics. We want our students to get as much hands-on experience as possible. And so we do have a few, and these student-run clinics are fully ran by the students, and they do have advisors that are either Columbia faculty or formerly Columbia faculty. Some are retired, but most of them, for the most part, kind of still practice. But our student-run clinics are like COSMO, or the Columbia Student Medical Outreach, Columbia Harlem Homeless Medical Partnership, what we call CHIMP, Columbia Care Access, or CCAP, and then our Human Rights Asylum Clinic offers free medical evaluations for those seeking asylum here in the US. And then we have our student-run Q Clinic. And so all these clinics service the population between Harlem and Washington Heights at either a low to free cost. Housing is guaranteed all 4 years while you are on campus, but you do not have to live in on-campus housing at all. We do have an amazing housing office that will work with you to find off-campus housing if that's something that you're interested in. But if you do decide to want to live on campus, there's two styles. So 50 Haven is your more dormitory style, maybe what you're used to in college right now. It has amazing amenities. I know there's like a student lounge in there, a pool, it's where the free weight club is. So there is a lot of great amenities in there. But if you are more apartment style, which honestly would probably be me, you might want to go for the towers. And so the towers, like I said, has a full kitchen, full stove, is definitely what you're looking for if you're looking for more modern apartment style type. So back to the support program. So definitely it's important that our students feel supported outside of the classroom as much as they do inside of the classroom. And so these are just a few of our support programs, but we do have the advisory dean program. It's what I worked with closely in my time in student affairs. And so there are 6 advisory deans who each have a cohort of about 20 to 25 students, and they're like your front line of defense. You're feeling a little uneasy about an exam. If there's something that's going on within school or personal life or anything that you want to talk about, those are your go-to people. And they're definitely just all amazing. Our dean of admissions is actually an advisory dean, as well as the assistant dean of admissions. They both serve as advisory deans. So it was really cool to kind of be able to work with them and still be able to work with them. And I can't sing their praises highly enough. And then the senior associate dean for student affairs has daily walk-in hours. She's another one who really encourages students to come stop by. It's similar to our Office of Diversity and Multicultural Affairs. They have an open door policy. They always are encouraging students to just drop in, whether it's to chit chat or grab candy or grab some free food. They're always here for you. Our career advising specialist works with you to kind of get your residency application in preparation and make it as strong as possible. Our Student Success Network is a peer tutoring opportunity where we partner upperclassmen with incoming students. Our wellness office is amazing at providing support programs throughout the year, really focused on just like mental health and student health and wellness. And so they really do a great job with decompressing, especially around exam times. So they'll like bring pets, they'll do like a potting like a potting program in the springtime. Just really amazing at how they detail things around the time of the year. And then our Addiction Illness Medical Solutions, or what we call AIMS, is a program for anyone who might be dealing with some type of substance abuse. They're there to support you through that as well. So I'm gonna give you a virtual tour of our campus. Let's press play.
Welcome to the Columbia University Vagelos College of Physicians and Surgeons in New York City. We hope that this brief, virtual, student-led tour will help better orient you to the Columbia University Irving Medical Center campus and its surroundings. We'll introduce you to some of the places you'll be spending most of your time, like the Roy and Diana Vagelos Education Center, 50 Haven, Hammer Health Sciences Center, Haven Plaza, William Black Building, Milstein Hospital Building, and the Morgan Stanley Children's Hospital. Let's begin with an overview of the neighborhood.
Hi, everyone. My name is Jessica Ding, and I am a second-year medical student at Columbia. Our campus is within the Washington Heights neighborhood. It's a really vibrant area, and there's a diverse Spanish-speaking community with many people from the Dominican Republic. There's a lot to see and do here, like there are farmers markets, restaurants, and historic sites and landmarks such as the United Palace Theater. And a few blocks from campus, there's J. Hood Wright Park, where I have a lot of picnics with my friends. And a little farther north is the beautiful Fort Tryon Park, which is home to the cloisters at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. This neighborhood has the vibe of a small community within the bigger city, so it's not as crowded or overwhelming as some parts of downtown Manhattan might be.
Welcome to the Vagelos Education Center. My name is Billy Buffington, and I'm a third-year medical student here at Columbia. The award-winning Vagelos Education Center is a 14-story building that houses a high-tech simulation center, classrooms, social spaces, anatomy labs, and an auditorium. In the lobby on the first floor, you'll find a bustling open space with comfy furniture. Here we are in the Clyde and Helen Wu Auditorium. This space spans two floors. It's used for classes and for special events. What I love about the Vagelos Education Center are the incredible city views that can be seen on every floor. One of the coolest spaces is the Mary and Michael J. Harris Simulation Center. You will start working in the Sim Center during your first semester as part of the Clinical Skills Development in your Tutorials 1 course. There are many operating room settings in the Sim Center that let you practice key surgical skills in a low-risk setting. Another perk of the Vagelos Education Center is that it's open until 11 p.m., so you'll have plenty of time to study.
Welcome to 50 Haven. My name is Amy Hembry. I'm a second year medical student. 50 Haven is where medical students live and socialize on campus. It has a lot of great amenities, a free weight club, the athletic center, the pool, saunas, music rooms, and a laundry room. There's a lounge for student events and study spaces. A number of students live in 50 Haven during their first year, and there's 24-hour security, and rent is really reasonable for NYC. 50 Haven is also home to the PNS Club, the most comprehensive student activities organization in American medical education, with nearly 70 co-curricular and extracurricular organizations. I'm a member of the Walker Percy Literary Society, which is also known as Book Club.
Welcome to Hammer Health Sciences Center. My name is Andrew Sanchez. I'm a fourth-year medical student at Columbia University, and this is one of the buildings where I spend a lot of time on campus. On the first floor of this building is the Augusta C. Long Health Sciences Library, which is open 24/7 for students. Inside the space, you'll find printers and computer labs, and rooms for individual and small group study. Textbooks are free to check out, and there are also lots of free online resources. Right next door to the library is a cafe. While we are studying on the main and lower levels of Hammer, researchers are filling the labs on the upper floors with world-class research that has made Columbia a leader in biomedical research. For me, the best thing about the Hammer Library is what we call the Shark Tank. It's a quiet room and it has these little cubicles that are super duper comfortable to study in.
Welcome to Haven Plaza. This is one of the outdoor spaces that really makes our campus a treasure. Haven Plaza is a pedestrian plaza open to everyone at the Medical Center and the Washington Heights community. As you walk through the plaza, you will notice hand-painted illustrations of flowers, plants, and animals by local artist Emily Perez. This is a nice spot to gather with friends for lunch or to attend one of the public events hosted in the plaza throughout the year. There's also a cafe seating here right outside the Barnes & Noble bookstore, which is another popular spot for students. Haven Plaza is a great departure point for exploring. It's only a short walk to the 1A and C subway trains and to the George Washington Bridge bus station that will take you to other parts of the city. There's also an inter-campus shuttle that goes between Columbia campuses.
Welcome to the William Black Building. My name is Lauren, and I'm a fourth-year medical student at Columbia University. So the Black Building is one of the medical school's research buildings and is filled with laboratories conducting world-class research. The Black Building is home to the Alumni Auditorium and the Schaefer Awards Gallery. The gallery with its glassed-in facade is a nice spot to study or catch up with classmates. The Alumni Auditorium is where our Medical Center's theater company staged 3 productions per academic year. I personally like to relax in the student lounge during my clinical rotation while I'm waiting to be paged by the hospital.
Welcome to Milstein Hospital. This is one of the New York Presbyterian Hospital buildings where most of your clerkships will take place during the major clinical year. New York Presbyterian Hospital is ranked number 4 in the nation and number 1 in New York, according to U.S. News & World Report's Best Hospitals rankings. This building has 745 beds and over 30 ORs. It houses the Vivian Seymour Milstein Family Heart Center. One of my favorite parts about working here was probably working with the medicine residents. I'm applying into internal medicine this year, and I really enjoyed the amount of independence they gave us as medical students.
Welcome to Morgan Stanley Children's Hospital. This is the New York Presbyterian Hospital building, which is where, for many of you, your pediatrics clerkship will take place during your major clinical year. The garden behind the hospital is a nice place to take a break outdoors. There's also a piece of baseball history here in the garden. There's a home plate plaque honoring the New York Yankees' original stadium, Hilltop Park, in Washington Heights. Another fun fact is that New York Presbyterian Hospital is the official hospital of the New York Yankees.
And that concludes our virtual tour for today. Thank you for joining us. We look forward to seeing you in person very soon.
So I grew up near Yankee Stadium, so to know that NYP or New York Presbyterian is the hospital for the Yankees always makes me super happy. So admissions requirements. What does our committee look for in an applicant? And so these requirements, and I'll just give another disclaimer as well, these are always updating. And so this is currently what we're looking for. These are the most recent, but just because I know it's being recorded, I just want you all to know, definitely check in with us as far as the admissions requirements go, because they can change from year to year. But currently what we are looking for is at least 3 full academic years at an accredited college in the US or Canada at the time of your application. And then we want that bachelor's degree prior to your matriculation. 1 year of English or another writing intensive course. And what we constitute as writing intensive is anything that has at least 4 major papers. 1 year of biology with labs. If you did receive AP credit, we still require at least 1 year of an advanced study with 1 semester of lab. We do recommend 2, but if you can only get in 1, that's totally fine. 1 year of physics with labs. If you did receive AP credit, then no advanced study is required. We will accept the AP credit on that behalf. 2 years of chemistry, 1 of which must be organic chemistry, and both must obtain labs. If you received AP credit for general chem or intro chem, then no advanced study is required. We just would ask that you complete that organic chemistry with lab. And then biochem, 1 semester. Lab is not required, but we do recommend. And then stats and biostats are highly recommended, but they are not required. And then we ask that you take the MCAT within 3 years of you applying. So these were our current deadlines for this cycle. So the MCAS application generally becomes available in May. And then it was due this year, or it's gonna be due this year on October 15th. And so that just means submitting that primary application and having it verified by October 15th. And then our secondary, which is specific for Columbia VPNS, goes live July 1st. And so the deadline to submit that will be October 22nd of this year. And then our all materials deadline was November 12th. It's actually been pushed up to October 29th. So they give you another week after the secondary to get that in. I'll leave this up here for a second, but I'll also put it in the chat. Just our contact information. So if you ever have absolutely any questions regarding prerequisites or anything like that, definitely feel free to reach out to us via phone or email. especially email, just because we do have a prerequisites committee. So maybe there's a course that you're not sure if it'll fulfill the requirement. Definitely send us an email. We'll absolutely submit it to the prereqs committee and get a definitive answer for you. But yeah, someone's in the office literally from 8 to 5 every day. So if you ever want to give us a call just to chit chat, we love to answer phone calls as well. So I'll move on to the next slide, but I'll leave that up here too. So this is the admissions team. On the top left, we have Ms. Wendy Hernandez-Quinonez. She's the director of admissions, and she's sitting alongside Drs. Armstrong Coben and Dr. Donald Quest. And they're both the senior associate dean and assistant deans. They are both actually advisory deans as well. Below them is Ms. Ama Asante. She is the admissions and recruitment coordinator like myself. And then to the right, we have Mr. David Wigan and Major Hatch and me. And they are also admissions coordinators as well. We are on social media. Always try to send the plug. So definitely follow us on TikTok or Instagram. We will be moving on to other channels soon. But for now, we are on social media. So I'll leave this up for just a sec if you want to write it down. But definitely can feel free to keep up with what's going on in VPNS. These accounts are student run, so they're not official from the school. But it is our students just giving back and showing how great of a community it is here at VPNS. And then I want to show a video, but I'm actually going to exit full screen just because the video tends to lag in full screen. Before I start it, our students in the class of 2024 welcomed our class of 2025 with their own rendition of In the Heights. And so I'm gonna let you see a minute of it, but it's on YouTube. So if you wanna watch the full 7-minute video, just do Columbia In the Heights and you'll definitely see it pop up.
Lights up on Washington Heights, about the break of day, I wake up and I take a little run, I make some time to play.
Riverside, first thing in the morning, gotta get the gears turning for another day of learning.
On the anatomy schedule, you'll be doing the pterygopalatine fossa. And special, just for today, I've brought my cat.
This is our med school, and you probably want to check this out. Reports of our clout are greatly substantiated, enriched completely by the fact that our classmates are highly educated, and they translocated to the single greatest little place in New York City, 155th and Dyckman. I love it. Other schools are jealous of it.
And beyond that, empathy and compassion are what drives us. We came here to wise up. These are the vets that practice reflex on patella. Pre-Oscar trip to Hilltop. This corner is out of swelling now. You're probably thinking,
I'm up Schitt's Creek. I've never been north of 96th Street.
Well, you must take the A train. Even further than Harlem to northern Manhattan and maintain. Get off at 181st and take the escalator. I hope you're writing this down. I'm gonna test you later.
We do get tested once a month. We flex our knowledge. When we pass to our props, we must pay homage. So much to do.
A clinic and some interest groups.
So many dogs.
Avoid their poop. Watch class at 2x speed. And when we're done, we hit the stew.
In the Heights, lift flash cars and start my day.
Yeah, but like it goes forever and ever, and it's actually an amazing video to watch, so highly recommend it. But at this point, I'm going to actually allow Simi to introduce herself. She's one of our first year medical students and an amazing, amazing woman. Thank you so much for joining me.
Of course, thank you, Kiana. Hi, everybody. My name is Simi. I am an M1. So I just started about like, I guess it's like 2 months now, which is kind of crazy. But yeah, that's me. I currently live off campus, but like extremely close to the VEC. So that's really great. And yeah, and I'm actually currently in Hammer Health Sciences Library. So.
And where are you from, Simi? What school did you go to?
That's like, I'm so sorry. I'm going to
It's okay. It's a long day.
Oh gosh. I'm from St. Louis, Missouri, and I went to Harvard for undergrad. And I took 2 gap years before starting med school.
Oh, Awesome. So yeah, at this point, we can open up the floor to any questions.
And I'm happy to answer anything about like housing, social stuff, how classes are going, things like that, how like the transition is. I'm still very much transitioning, but how it's going so far.
And if you don't feel comfortable coming off the camera, it's totally fine. You don't have to. You can also put it in the chat as well.
And also, if nobody has any questions, oh, Alonzo does, but after Alonzo, if nobody else has questions, we do have some prepared questions ready, so we'll have questions ready.
Yes. But, yes, Alonzo.
Hello. Hey, thank you so much for the presentation. And I do have a question. Coming off of your gap year, how was your transition into, I guess, medical school? And what did you do between those two gap years that you were taking?
Yeah, that's a good question. Thank you. So I was doing my master's of public health, actually. So I was still in school from the time I graduated college. But I would definitely say it's like a lot more of a transition in the fact that like my master's program was like very, I would say like very like collaborative like projects, if that makes sense, and like a lot of research. So I think that going from that to more of a situation with like all of these classes, you were kind of had to study more individually, or like if you need to like study with a group, things like that, just going off from like group projects to like back to like individual testing was a little bit of, or is a little bit of a difficult transition, I would say. But I think that there's so many resources that Columbia offers that makes it really easy for us. So for example, one of my favorite things to use is the Student Success Network. And it's essentially like a student, it's basically like a student-led kind of like academic assistance program. So like every week they'll host review sessions for like some of our classes. They also have like old study guides and like old questions or like practice questions that you can use for the exam. So I think it just really makes it a lot easier, even when like the information feels like really overwhelming. And so I would say that, and then in addition to that, like fellow students are really supportive, especially like our M2s. They're like, oh, like y'all need to relax. Like, this is what you need to do to succeed. Like, we had a meeting about that maybe in the like first or second week of school, just telling us like, these are the steps to make sure that like you do well and like we're here for you. So I think having that structural support in terms of like things like SSM and like all the different offices that Columbia provides, plus the students, makes the transition like a lot easier.
Thank you for that.
Of course. So I actually just had a question come in from somebody. I guess this would be more for you, Ms. Ramos, but somebody would like to know what the average MCAT and GPA was for the class.
Yeah, absolutely. So we look more to ranges than we do for medians or anything like that. But for Simi's class, the MCAT ranged from a 508 to a 528. And the GPA range from a 3.3 to a 4.0. If you do want to know the median MCAT's around a 5.22, and GPA is around 3.9. But we do look more to range. I will say that there is no particular GPA or MCAT, you know, that we look for per se. We do review applications holistically. So your GPA and your MCAT are not the determining factor of whether you'll be invited for an interview or eventually accepted. It does get taken into consideration. However, we do want to read your personal statement. What's your motivations to medicine? What experiences do you have, whether it's clinical, research, community service, any non-clinical work that really stands out, what your hobbies are? We like to see students who are passionate and committed to their passions. So that stands out a lot more. But yeah, our range was a 508 to a 528 and a 3.3 to a 4.0.
Okay, thank you for that. I actually forgot to introduce somebody, Dorian. Dorian is our wonderful treasurer for the Health Careers Club, and she will be helping me kind of moderate the questions. So Dorian, if you have any questions, or if you can kind of ask one of the questions that I sent you, that would be great.
I see Alonzo has his hand up too again.
Okay. I'll go ahead, Alonzo.
Oh, I can go after Dorian. It's fine.
Okay, hello everyone, and I have a question for Simi. As of right now, what is your interest for your career? And then can you just say how your preparation to school helped guide you, and how did you display that within your application?
Yeah. So I would say that my interest currently now, I'm trying to keep an open mind just because right now, like in the first year, like it's very much focused on making sure that you can get through all of the classes. But I think coming in, I am either interested in being an OBGYN or a surgeon. I don't know what type though. So I think that's like something that I hope I can kind of further clear up through like shadowing, which I'm hoping to do in the next few like months or so, as I'm getting like more acclimated to school and everything, as well as of course our major clinical year, which starts in I think January of our second year. But I would say that what kind of led me into those interests was actually through my master's program. Starting undergrad, I had no idea that I wanted to go into medicine, but I didn't know much about public health actually. And then it was only like maybe in my sophomore year that I did this like internship, and I realized like how important like community health initiatives and community health research were in addressing health disparities, which was something that I was like always interested in, like even before college. So that's why I decided to do the master's. And then in my program, I did a lot of research in Black maternal health outcomes in New Haven, Connecticut. And then also doing a lot of like community work in terms of like increasing, trying to understand how we can increase rates of breastfeeding among Black and Latino mothers. Also doing like a few, like working with like a few like organizations and like doing diaper drives and like just like working with moms. And I think that really helped solidify my interest in Black maternal health and also in working with like moms in general. But I'm still kind of figuring out my path. And I think that through, at least so far, like I feel like Columbia has been really supportive in that. Like, for example, students will send in shadowing opportunities for like different specialties, like ear, nose, and throat. There's like an OBGYN one that's in January that like I'm signed up for. There's just so many, like even like suturing workshops. Just, it's like very much you would have the ability to pick and choose like what you would want to be like involved in. But yeah, I would say that's kind of like my journey into my interest that I have right now.
Thank you.
Alonzo.
Okay, thank you. So my question was for Ms. Ramos. Or is it Ramos? I'm sorry if I pronounced it.
Either or goes with me, it's fine.
Right, thank you. So if you were to apply to if you're interested in applying to a dual degree program, whether it's the MD or MS, would you be able to apply to the MD program? And then later on in your track, if you decided to go down a dual degree route, kind of change over to that? Or would you have to initially come in as a dual degree applicant?
Yeah, absolutely. That's a great question. So the only program tracks that you would have to declare at the time of your application would be if you were wanting to pursue the BSET track, the PhD to MD track, or the MD PhD track. So it's really hard to kind of go into the MD to MD PhD. So if you're going to do any of those three, you have to declare that at the time of your application. But if you're doing like an MS, an MPH, an MBA, or anything like that, yeah, you can decide that later on down the line. And so ideally you wouldn't even be able to complete that dual degree until after your third year. And so you would have definitely enough time to decide, you know what, hey, I want to pick up a MS in narrative medicine or something, and then proceed to do that.
Thank you again.
Mm-hmm.
Brooklyn.
Hello, my name is Brooklyn Wallace. I'm a biology pre-med major from Dallas, Texas, and I had a question for Simi and for Ms. Ramos. So my question for Ms. Ramos is, doing a gap year and doing research or things along that line, does that strengthen your application?
Yeah, so we just want to say that you're doing something in your gap year. whether it is research, whether it's clinical experience, whether it's you taking time to study abroad, whether you decide you want to actually pursue a career for a year, maybe you want to be a teacher or interpreter or anything, we just want to make sure that you're doing something within that gap year. So I wouldn't necessarily say it strengthens the application or weakens it. Those who decide to take 10 years off, do a whole career, and then come to med school have the same amount of chance as anyone who just came directly from undergrad or who took a gap year. It's just, we just like to see what you did within that time.
Okay, thank you. And then my question for Simi was, do you think that taking a gap year better prepared you for medical school? Like, did it give you a second to kind of breathe, like coming from undergraduate?
Yes, I would say at least for me, like my transition from high school to college was like a little, it was a little rough. I think just trying to like transition to like understand, like how to basically learn in a new environment. And I think that medical school is very much the same. Like you've done a lot of pre-med classes and they are like really difficult and really tough. But I think that when with like medical school, I think with the amount of information that you're kind of like expected to know or learn, at least be familiar with, is a lot more. And I think that that really has, it really like gives everyone an opportunity to kind of start at the same level and like basically learn what's the best way for you to study. So I think that just that being said, I feel like the 2 years I took for my master's was definitely a little bit more chill than college. And I think it gave me time to, one, again, as I was talking about, like with my interest in Black maternal health, hone in on like what I wanted to do, what I would potentially want to do, and what I want to focus on. And it also gave me an opportunity to like give back while I was like still in school, which was something that was really important to me and something that I was even looking for in a medical school as well. Yeah, but I would say that that being said, I did take my MCAT and apply. I took my MCAT during my master's program and I applied during that year. So it was a little, there were some times where it was a little hectic, but I would say that in general, like it was definitely like a good break, but like also because I was still in school at the time, I was like still doing something that was kind of propelling me like on what I would be my future career.
Okay, thank you.
And I think there's also, sorry, really quickly, I think as Carol was saying, there's a lot of my friends, it's a mix of like people who just graduated from college and people who've taken between one and like 4 or 5 gap years. So there's definitely, and people have done a variety of things of like from consulting to working, like doing research, teaching as well. So there's definitely a lot of different options. It's not like necessarily, oh, you have to get a degree or you have to do research. It's just whatever you're passionate about.
Thank you.
Cheyenne.
Hi, my name is Cheyenne Cece. I'm a sophomore health science major at Spelman. I have two questions. The first one is your school, like, is Columbia catered more towards like aspiring surgeons or is it just physicians in general? And then my second question is, what are the student demographics and diversity at Columbia?
Yeah, absolutely. So the school is called the Vagelos College of Physicians and Surgeons, but it is well-rounded. So it's not just for surgeons. Literally any medical specialty you're interested in going into, so whether it be dermatology, neuro, OB-GYN, ophthalmology, literally anything, you can definitely be here. As far as our demographics go, I can actually, let me pull it up. I'll share it with you all because it is on our website. But this year we achieved at least 31% underrepresented in medicine, which is our highest in a long time. So very proud of that. But let me pull up the actual numbers for you all. I mean, Simi, if you want to just add to the diversity in your
class. Sorry.
No, you're fine.
I would say it's a very diverse class. Definitely a lot more than I was expecting, and I think it was definitely one of the top reasons I ended up choosing Columbia, because I was like, oh, I see not only like students that look like me, but like faculty that look like me, like deans that look like me. I think that that was something that was really important, because it made me feel like I wouldn't be like left at the wayside of that road. But yeah, I think that it just made me feel, and I feel like other students that I'm like friends with and I'm getting to know, I think everyone has a great diversity of experiences, and everyone comes from different backgrounds. And I feel like every day you learn something about somebody that you're like, wow, like that's, I like haven't even thought about that, or that's not something that like I have experienced. So I'd say that it's like a very, very diverse class.
Yeah.
At least in my experience.
Yeah, so we have around 140 students total, of which 112 go into the MD, 10 go into our Columbia Bassett. We have two that, you know, come in from the dental school to do oral and maxillofacial. Then we have two PhD to MD students. So you can see that the Columbia Bassett, the MD, PhD, and the PhD to MD are the most competitive. We have a class of about 74 women and 66 men. As I mentioned, about 31 are underrepresented, which are about 43 students. We have about 27 states represented, about 11 first-generation students. And then we have over 49 colleges that were represented in about 13 foreign countries. We receive about 7,000 applications, and that's with the secondary being submitted, and then we interview around 870. And then, as I mentioned, we only accept about 140.
Awesome, thank you.
Does anyone else have any questions before we turn to the ones we already have prepared?
I have a question. Hi, my name is Sakai Parker. I'm a second year health science major, Spanish minor on the pre-med track from Washington, DC. Thank you so much for coming today. One of my questions that I had was, so could you go back to that slide where you were talking about the curriculum breakdown?
Yes.
Throughout the 4 years, because I had a question about that.
No, let me go scroll.
Yeah. Okay, So for each of these like different aspects of the curriculum, how are M1s, M2s, M3s, and M4s bonding more so, or how are they socializing with each other if they're in completely different, I guess, stages in their curriculum, if that makes sense? Like,
yeah,
classes together, are they, like, can you talk a little bit more about that?
Yeah, so definitely, that's a great question. So right now, the M2s are currently in their last season of the fundamental courses, while the M1s are just getting their feet wet. And so I would say this is a good time for them to kind of bond, just because, again, with the Student Success Network and with just them having group me's and just meetups through the affinity groups, whether it be BALSO, FLIP, APAMSA, or LAMDA, that's all times in which they kind of come back together. I will say, too, major clinical year is a little harder. Especially because the class does get broken down into, like I said, 8 groups. So even then, like when Simi goes into her major clinical year, she won't even see some of her own classmates because they'll be in different rotations throughout their time. But they do get to see each other again for MMP week. And so the third and fourth years have a little more flexibility in their schedules. So they will come to sometimes campus events. Sometimes they'll rejoin those affinity groups. They will have those times. And again, I think that they're just amazing at the meetups. I think I get a little jealous. I wish I was a student sometimes to like come hang out with the BALSO, the Black and Latino Student Org students. but they definitely do have a great way of staying connected and communicating. And I think what's awesome is that the third and fourth years want to make sure that the first and second years are succeeding and doing their best through MCY. So that way they're always like providing some type of advice or telling them what to look out for, or things that they can be getting involved in or things to look out for. So I'd say between that and like, again, social events, things that the school puts on every now and again, we try to do have events where they all can come together. Recently we had the boat cruise that was for all 4 years. And so that was a fun opportunity for M1s to meet M4s and things like that as well.
And if I can add on to that, I think that was something I was definitely worried about too. But they're through, I think, the PNS club, they have like little sib programs. And like, that's something I signed up for. I also have like a BALSO family, and I'm connected with, I think, an two M2s and one M4. I'm like friends with an M3, which I'm surprised, like, not with, I was still worried. I was like, oh, like, you know, they're like, they're really in the thick of it. So like, will I be able to see like entries? But I think that everyone is really invested in like the Columbia community, who are really invested in BALSA. So it's really, it's actually like a lot easier than I thought to see like second, third, and fourth years than I was like, I think even told like as I was like interviewing and during like second looks and stuff like that.
Yeah, to piggyback, we do recruit heavy for our fourth years and our third years for those upperclassmen to do tours to help lead and do all the second look revisit things, so that way you do get a little bit of exposure to them. And they're awesome at like sharing their contact information, their personal cell phone numbers, their personal emails. So they do love to keep that conversation going and keep those relationships going.
I had another question as well. Are there any opportunities for scholarships for undergrads coming in, or for students coming in general?
Yeah, so we do have the Vagelos Endowment Fund, which if your family makes under $125,000 collectively, you go to school for free. full cost of attendance, there it goes. But there are also scholarships. A lot of financial aid is on a case-by-case need-based basis. However, closed mouth don't get fed. I love to say this, I probably shouldn't. But yeah, definitely if you need, you ask.
I know we're almost at time, but I have a question for Simi. I apologize, I forgot where you said you're from, but moving to New York, what was that like? Like moving to a big city, is it safe? Do you like it? What do you do for fun outside of class? Like just a general impression of New York.
Simi, you better be honest over here. New York is the best city.
It is the best city. I even claim that I'm from Brooklyn, even though I'm from St. Louis. So I love New York like so much. So I moved here officially like in August, right before school started. But I would say that like I visited New York like a few times before then, because like where I was for undergrad was like pretty close, and like I was in New York kind of a little often. So I really like it. I think that there is so much to do in the city. It's like, it's kind of crazy. Like it's almost sometimes too much to do. So you kind of have to be like, should I go out or should I, you know, be in my books? So I think that like and one of the great things is that there's something for everyone. So if it's like, oh, parties or like maybe like a spoken word night, even just like outside of the school itself, there's just always something to do. I will say that I guess maybe the one downside I would say about New York is that things are a little expensive, but I think that that's kind of something that we all kind of have to unfortunately get like used to, and it's just about like all like managing your money and things like that. But I would say that like I feel like everyone, even though it's like New York, and I feel like the stereotype is like, oh, like New Yorkers are like a little like a little mean. Like I would say that like I did have not, for the most part, not have that experience, and I really love it. It's
great. Thank you so much. Does anyone have any last minute questions, comments, anything you want to say?
Yeah, and I'll drop my email in the chat as well. So like, if you have any other questions, please feel free to reach out to me.
Same. I'm going to put my personal email first, and then I'll put the office one as well again. This is fun. I definitely hope that we can do this again, that this isn't a one-time thing, but that we definitely keep this relationship going, because my goal is definitely to increase diversity here at Columbia. It's really important to me. That is part of my job, and I really love it. And so just to see some of your amazing faces come across my screen when we go to screen applications would be a blessing. So definitely hope to maintain this relationship and definitely keep Morehouse and Spelman going and getting those numbers up at Columbia. But yeah, definitely feel free to reach out to me or send me if you have absolutely anything. If you're looking to maybe get in contact with the physician, or you're just trying to shadow, if you're going to be in the city, I'll also send Ariana some of our pipeline programs that you could definitely take advantage of through our Office of Diversity and Multicultural Affairs. They're from literally freshman year of college all the way to senior year. So I'll send out some of that information as well so you can get involved as well.
Great. Thank you so much, Ms. Ramos and Simi, for taking the time out your very busy schedules to talk with us. I'll definitely maintain contact with you, and hopefully we can do something like this again in spring. But if no one else has any questions, Ms. Ramos, you can start recording now. I hope you all have a great